idealist. And I'll just start off. An idealist. Some call me an idealist. With fanciful notions about life. Unreasonable expectations. A hopeless romantic. Some would call me a visionary, whose thoughts are often centered on the imaginary. Nay, nay, nay. I am a realist. My dreams and aspirations are attainable. The future I dream for, I can reach. No matter how high I set my goals, I will reach them. Why? Because I am a realist.
Woo! Next up, I got here a poem by Mr. Jacob Miller.
Hazel eyes watched intently as I ran and fell and bled so empty. I ran for her and tripped aplenty. A hopeless hope, my hair unkempt, my shirt disheveled, my grin was bent. The hazel eyes did laugh at these efforts of mine, and then the swim across the sea, bones soaked in brine. Those hazel eyes had demons, beautiful and cruel. A single glance makes me a fool. Hearts beating at different paces, eyes looking to different places. I watched on as she went through moonlight phases, each day attempting brand new faces. The hazel eyes called out, but forbade entry, ignoring the love and support and gentry. I raised my white flag, hoping she'd pause, maybe consider the time I'd lost. But those hazel eyes continued firing, her constant games never tiring. So here I am, not quite shattered, lost without all that ever mattered. Against my ribcage, my heartbeat clattered. Tears exploding as from a two-fold bladder. The hazel eyes now dance with another, because I, the fool, am like a brother. The hazel eyes are shut to me, like I'm a dog and she's the wrong tree. The hazel eyes, fringed with green, innocent devils, dangerous daughters, and the keys to everything.
Next up, I got Evelyn Vargas.
Hey guys! So mine is called A Good Hair Day. Curly, curly, curly. Girly, girly, girly. It's not black, it's brown. No, I cannot frown. On 2 feet I stand, the whole world in hand. Learning, learning, learning. Twirling, twirling, twirling.
Next up is gonna be Miss Adeline Jacobs.
Yay. Everybody, my poem is called Body of Braille. Whenever we touch, let it be in the dark. Let's wrap ourselves in a cloak cut from the night sky anytime we hold hands or share a kiss. Before you hug me, turn the lights off. Make the world dark so you can't see me. Make it so that I don't have to be so exposed. I am not ready for you to see me in the light. Your eyes seeing all of the things that I wish to ignore. Whenever we touch, let it be in the dark, so you can't see my skin. It is not that I don't like the way I feel in my skin, but I hate the way my skin feels. The bumps and ridges of stretch marks, scars of the emotional battles that I lost to food. Before you wrap your arms around my waist, turn off the lights. Because the stretch marks on my body are braille, for I want you to know my story, but not see it. You read my story in the dark with your hands on my hips, and the story ends at my waist, leaving you with a cliffhanger. You don't know if you want to read the rest of the story. I don't want there to be more of the story, and neither of us knows whether or not to be in awe of the beauty or horrified by my tale. You trace your fingers along the pink and purple lines that spell out every calorie I've consumed because of feelings, and I shudder. Because your fingers are feather light, and I am afraid you will be as terrified of my body as I once was when we finally decide to turn on the lights.
Now we keep thinking thin. You help me get out of things and swings. You always check me from good and bad. I would always get mad, but now I'm glad. I would always try to fight when you were right, and now I'm towards the end. Who whoever is out there that has bends and dents, you're not alone. Nobody is perfect. Just like Anne Lamott said, perfection is shallow, unreal, and fatal, and highly uninteresting. But in the end, these are two different subjects, but they were two confessions, because they both needed family. Family gives a great sensation of love, peace, and correction. You'll be thankful of what they say and do, so say them.
All right, next up is going to be Alison Morales.
It's called Quick Time. Your sister is sick. Death calls its hands around her delicate throat. Brilliant black blood swelling from her new stung lips. You set out to find a cure, for who knows better than a witch the power of blood. The forest is dead, and a deep, powerful smell fills the air. Snakes slither underneath your fingertips. You cough, wipe your mouth, your hand comes back wet, and the blood is black. When you find the witch, sitting in a blade of small white flowers, her hair is the same color as your father's smiling red throat, and her twinkling laughter obscene. She mixes potions and brews for your sister. They smell of white flowers and concentrated starlight. And she adds small portions of your deceased blood. You bundle the crystalline cure in your skirts and smile, black blood dripping from your mouth to the floor of the love mollified. The witch gives you her favor as you leave her home, and the flowers are as pretty as Queen Anne's lace. But they burn down your throat, and too late you realize. Your sister dies 2 days later, coughing bloody sacks of soap, and your name on her lips.
All right, this one is called The World is Gray Again. There's a comma, that's why there's a pause. I'm sitting in the dark in the blue-gray TV light, and there's this strangely buzzing silence that seems to permeate the night. And I'm just thinking how I miss you. Could I go back to stop that fight? I know what I said was wrong, Tex. No, I wasn't in the right. I wish that you would tell me, though, why you let us break apart. Just like I pray that God could show me how to save this failing heart. I wish I could go backwards. Could I maybe hit restart? Maybe I'd do something better this time. Maybe I'd have been smart. It's been 8 weeks since you left me. Spent 8 weeks all alone, and I am just dying to hear your voice again. But I won't hit dial on my phone. I know that you won't answer, but when I'm far from you, I'm far from home. The more that you ignore me, the more my head is thrown. I miss your hands within mine. I miss your sparkling eyes. I miss the grins and laughter. I miss the smirks and sighs. I miss the blessing that I had when your singing voice would rise. And worst of all, I know I can't be a part of your life. I don't know if any of you have ever felt this way before. When you miss someone so desperately, you think about them more. And the memories make you so happy and then shake you to your core. You told me once your world was gray. I guess that makes me an artist. Because you told me next you saw the sun, the sky, and showed me where your heart is. Now my world is gray. You took the color with your eyes. The grass is always greener, though you can't say I didn't try. I'm looking at this picture now, the last one that I've got, and I have never missed your smile more. It tears me apart with every thought. It's 2 a.m. again, Tex, hair ruffled, eyes bloodshot, and I just wanted to say that I'm sorry for any tears I may have brought, for all the hurt I've much regret, but for loving you, I'm not.
It's called Discarded but Not Forgotten. The death of an attachment is like greasing origami paper. Our hands folded and molded, and gradually in our palms, we held vastly different shapes. Somewhere along the lines, we crinkled the wrong place or extended too far, and lost exactly where our places are. Complex and intricate, we formed beautiful things of white-dyed cranes and orange-speckled butterflies. I realized that though we both took flight, our destinations were never the same. The wrinkled edges and smooth surfaces, the remembrance of our days are long faded now, and my patience along with it.
My poem is called Thanks for Being in My Life. All day, I look forward to being with you. All day, I long to hold you in my hands. All day, I wait to have the taste of you on my tongue. You will always be beautiful to me. While others may find you disgusting, I think you to be perfect. When I am done with the world, you comfort me. Your glossy, smooth surface crashing into my lips. I will gaze upon your beauty, and a sigh will escape me. Slowly, I will say, I love donuts.
Make things eternal. I hope to be remembered as a woman who made a difference.
Curtis is called Spiders, Stars, and Street Lamps. She walked her bare street, asphalt void of cars, but she had her sight only on the sky. With a constellation in her eye, something inside said, "Take me to my stars." Stopped her steps on concrete, eyes set on Mars. She did not know if it was her own mind. If she said she didn't want it, she lied. So she said quiet, "Take me to my stars." But someone, something, heard her quietly, and paranoia stepped out from the shadows. With his yellow grin and cold wind blows with him, the stars she loved can't set her free. He said he'd do just what she asked of him. His crooked grin would just steal her from him.
Megan Richards, read by Jacob Miller.
Yeah. This is the last time, I promise. My friend Megan Richards wasn't able to come tonight, but she wanted her poem read still, so she gave it to me because apparently I'm good at this. It's called The Mistake of Hatred. It seems like an eternity of days I've spent without my sister, but in reality, now it's been only five. Five long, hard days that I've had to cope with and think over all the selfish mistakes that I had several chances to change, but didn't. I refused. Last I saw her, conscious of her surroundings and with at least a little color in her cheeks, she lay there in a hospital bed, wide awake and well. Or so it seemed, but clearly, it was just a dream. A dream that, to my greatest disappointment, would never come true. Not in a million years. I left the room for those short 5 minutes for something minuscule and so unimportant, it's escaped my memory. This was just after I just made her laugh at something only a childish and playful 7-year-old girl would laugh at. What I said to her was also unimportant. It was the laugh I treasured from her. The last one I'd ever hear from her. When I came back, though, her eyes were closed, and all I heard was one long, intense beeping sound I knew all too well, as nurses rushed around almost in slow motion. Apparently, somehow, and in some way possible, she'd stopped breathing. Her body had finally given up, like I wish mine would. She was lucky enough to have her pain relieved, but I wasn't. After a minute of me standing there, staggering to grasp the concept, everything slowed to a stop. The nurses left and had taken out all the needles full of wasted blood that seemed more of a hindrance to her than a help. In the condition my sister was in, soon everyone stopped trying to help her. She couldn't be helped anymore. They covered her in a body bag that did no justice to the poor, sweet girl whom I'd once ignored for selfish reasons, and I fell to my knees on her hospital room floor, wondering what she possibly could have done to deserve this. I stared dumbfounded and racked my brain, thinking of what such a beautiful, innocent girl could have possibly done to die at such a young age. The only person I knew who did deserve to die was me. She had so much more to live for than me. Our parents weren't even there to see the absolute disaster I'd seen, the loss of their daughter. Dad was at work, but Mom had passed away in the birth of my sister. She was probably somewhere in heaven, just waiting for my sister to join her. That was the only consolation I had, the fact that she was going to heaven. One constant thought travels through my head for days after the new worst day of my life. I hated my sister when she was born. But now, I was sorry to let her go. I thought she had ruined my life by killing my mother, the mother I had only known till I was 9, and stealing baseball from me, the only thing I ever enjoyed. But in reality, she'd given me a new life that I had failed to take advantage of. She'd given me something much better than baseball ever could. Love and forgiveness. The only mistake that Angel ever did was to treat me, the jerk who did nothing for her, as nice as she did. If that wasn't a mistake, then the only real mistake she ever had was having me for a brother.
Oh, no. say this. I would not say that you are perfection. When I gaze at you with affection, I would say you have many flaws, all of which I love because they are all things that I would miss. I love the way you say my name, your long-held dream to come to fame, the hair that curls around your eyes, and when you sleep, your gentle sighs. There are too many things to list. I could compare you to a summer's day, but from Shakespeare you stay away. I hope this comes across with feeling. You're the only one I find appealing. It is with love I say this.
Alright, so I'm gonna take a totally different note. Not talking about donuts anymore. Okay. So this poem is called The Dance Called Life. The music will start. Pairs make their way to the center of the room, spinning, twirling, laughing, crying, singing, screaming to the world. What a wonderful person I have here with me. Behold, watch me as I dance with the highlight of my life. The people will sway to the music of time and dance the dance called love. The lights have now dimmed, but their happiness illuminates the room like a brilliant sun. Pairs of people, not defined by their race or gender or age or religion, nor by their mistakes or failures. To watch them is a sickening joy. To see them step on each other's toes, wet the other's shoulders with tears, laugh until their sides hurt. It's aching to watch, but the pain comes most when you look away. The pairs of people gather close together, dancing, bleeding, jumping, flying, smiling, yelling to the world. What an important person I have here with me. Behold, watch me as I dance with my solid foundation. And the people will sway to the music of time and dance the dance called life. Now I do not have a partner, a person I know who will dance with me until the song ends. No, I do not have that. I've had people who come and go, those that enjoy the quick conversation, and those who do not stay long enough to hear my name leave my lips. There have been times when people have come and said to me, I will be there until the last note is played. I will dance with you until my feet have fallen off. I will stand with you forever. But forever is long, and not everyone likes to stand even if they say they do. And they will leave when they find somebody who prefers to sit. So I will stand. Alone in the dark, eyes glued to the dancing pairs before me. I will plant my back against the wall and accompany the thorns and flowers that will grow there with me. Now I am not the only one who is stuck to the wall, cursed to watch the people who talk nothing in the other's ear, loving, hating, feeling, proclaiming, skipping, whispering. What a loyal friend I have here with me. Behold, watch me as I dance with my trusted secrets. People will sway to the music of time and dance the dance called life. The others like me, hidden in the dark and caved by our own thorns, but us, we cannot see each other, nor do we have the courage to go look in fear we might dance with somebody who has already found a partner. So I stay put, letting my roots grow deeper and deeper until they are too strong for me to break free. There is nothing to be done but stand and allow the nothing to wrap its tight arms around me, to have their darkness hold my tears, to let the broken pieces of my soul whisper to no one, to scream with a violent silence, praying that someone might hear. The people will kiss to an escape, touching, daring, watching, embracing, sparking, rejoicing. What a beautiful person I have here with me. Behold, watch me as I dance with the meaning behind my smile. The people will sway to the music of time and dance the dance called life.
My poem is called Depression. Depression feels like thousands of pounds of bricks stacked under death. You can't hear all the voices crying for help, but you can taste the salt of tears in your mouth. You can see people walking past and not trying to help. You're so built up in your immune system that you can't smell anything. You grab your pillow and clutch as hard as you can, and you scream as if you're alone in your bedroom. You feel your bones being crushed by the weight of the pain. You see your reflection of pain in your eyes. You taste the bitter regrets and mistakes you made. Finally, you let out all the salty tears from your eyes. They're swelled shut. You can't see anything.
feel like you're drowning under gallons of water and not coming up air. Depression makes you feel so numb that you can't feel your body aching.
Nina Gerges.
He is the one who is fixed on Starlight, one who values the tranquility of the darkness. He is one who appreciates the chirps of his lovely night, one who loves her in the dusk more often than in the fluorescence of light, one who concentrates on serenity and peace. He is the one who reignites the sparkling sunlight. For her, he is one who would not back down from his fights, one who adores the gleam of her howling moon. He is one who appreciates the chirps of his lovely night. He is one that loves to live without the bright and desires to sing calming lullabies to quiet her sweet mind. He is the one who reignites the sparkling sunlight. One who enjoys to see things in her version of black and white. Sleep well, don't let the bed bugs bite, for he is the one who appreciates the chirps of his lovely night. He is the one who reignites the sparkling sunlight.
Who you are, for what am I? I'm the person who keeps you up at night with golden rings and bad dreams. I'm the person who leaves you with dry tears, stain your pillow and clean your eyes. I'm the person that you love the most, but I'm also the person that you hate the most. The person that tells you to shut up because no one's listening. The person that causes you the most pain, but also the most happiness. I give you everything, but sometimes nothing at all. I'm your biggest fan, but your biggest enemy. I'm the person that makes you, you. I can make you feel like the ugliest person in the world, or sometimes the prettiest. I'm the person that makes you catch feelings. I can make you overthink the simplest things. I can make you jealous over the stupidest things. I can make you do anything. I'm the person that you just can't let go of. I'm that good. Who am I, you ask? Who am I? Who are you? You don't know the half of what I can do. I can cause the most destruction in a matter of seconds. I can break you. I can tear you to shreds. I can ruin you. Of course, you think that cool, but I'm stronger than you. I always have been. When you look in the mirror, it reflects the biggest blue you could ever have. Me? Me. Have you figured it out yet? I am you.
I'm Crashfire, and this poem is called Fairy Tales. I used to live in a world of fairy tales and escape from my father, given issues about love. Hide in stories about daring heroes and princesses, a refugee from my stepmother who furthered my issues. I'd live in every imaginable world of make-believe, rarely visiting reality. I've watched every Disney film, can quote Sleeping Beauty, Grimm, or other. Reality became a distant scent I couldn't remember, but I've always been told that scent is the human's strongest memory trigger. I'd have to fight harder to stay with my hero before the smell of responsibility had me again. My dances with the prince always cut short as the aroma of love isn't real cookies brought me back. But after one evacuation from the fairy tale realm, I found you, trying to save me from a dodgeball. And the next time in French, when you went into your work and drove me insane. And another, when you learned I play guitar and wanted me for your band. Slowly, I stayed more in reality, still visiting fairy tales, but just for the story. You made reality feel like magic. Every bad romance novel written couldn't describe this, nor Disney or Pixar. But I'm maddeningly Disney fairy tale in love with you, happily ever after.
Hi, I'm Vanya. My poem is called Dad. A letter to my father. This poem is for the one who loved me. These words full of appreciation and grace for the support of my dreams. The strong lilac butterfly who flew across borders and left their homeland for my education. This poem is for the one who stayed. Stayed to show me how to love others. How to keep fighting. How to fulfill the American dream. But this was not you, father. So, a letter to my mother. All these words go out to you and more. May they cling like thorns on roses because you are both a mother and a father. Because you are no coward, Mama. You raised all your equals. Usted, Madre Mia, means a young and cry. Our bond is planted in the roots of the everlasting maple fields of your home. Yo la sigo. I will follow you. Yo escucho sus palabras. I will listen to your words. Because you made me
selfish, but I find it very comforting. If I look down, there they are, just being cute. So, what if I know if everything is crumbling, whether my heart has fallen out of my chest, and my brain shuts itself off for protection and nothing is accessible, everything is fine. There's cats on my shoes. If I don't know what to say, I can hide with these shoes and keep my head down. No one notices either way. Because if ignorance was currency, we'd be rich. We'd hide behind the clouds of smoke, face boosters, and fake smiles. We find the answers at the bottoms of bottles and slip into that mindless oblivion. We stray from the obvious problems around us to search for what gives us that happiness. We are taught to be successful and that money doesn't matter. That happiness is the main goal in our lives. Success stopped being measured in happiness when the dollar bill determined if you eat today or not. There's cats on my shoes, so everything's fine. Thank you.
Hey, I'm Rachel. So I'm going to read my poem called Coffee Shop. Lux has a cute little coffee shop around the corner. Every day people would drive to the lovely street corner. Noses would perk up to the happy smelling coffee beans. But when you look around the corner, you can see the coffee loving teens. If you glanced over to the side, you can come across the soothing van. Then you could look over to the register and see all the credit cards being scanned. Sitting outside, ears were serenaded with soft tunes, and the sound of people stirring their coffee with spoons. As the espresso machine hummed, the walking bystanders drummed. They walked in and were greeted with the nicest smiles. Looking around, the customers' smiles went on for miles. Sitting down, they were pleased with their hot cup of coffee. It tasted like a hot cup of toffee. They stirred the coffee to mix in the foam. When they were finished, they walked out and once again began to roll.
This one is not as negative as all the other ones. So, it's called A Song for Someone. I gathered up the courage to hold... that's not what it says. I gathered up the courage to kiss your hand today, and it felt just like the first time I spoke to you last May. I'm drifting through my day now, still caught up in that moment when I saw your hand look cold and asked if I could hold it. A piece of me is dying to be right there where you are, but waves do have to pull us so very far apart. So I'm waiting for the tide to sink, waiting for an opportunity to run back into your arms, though not without impunity. Every time that we are close, my heart swells up with hope, though soon I'll have to leave, and that's just too much for me. I'm hopeless as the waves again pull us far apart, and there's nothing that can really slow my rapid beating heart. Just know that I will swim for you in any storm or sun, because every time I see you, I know my heart is won. I'll pull you back into my arms, hair dripping, bones soaked, and give you one last goodnight kiss, returning my lost hope.
This isn't one of my poems, but this is a poem by a woman I know, and it's really, really good, so I want to share it with you all. When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be? Will I be pretty? Will I be pretty? Will I be pretty? Oh, right, what comes next? Will I be rich? Which is almost pretty, depending on where you shop. And the pretty question, which affects from conception, passing blood and breath into cells, the word hangs from our mother's hearts in a shrill, fluorescent floodlight of worry. Will I be pretty, worthy, wanted? But pure theory left me this funhouse mirror dryad, teeth set at science fiction angles, crooked nose, face donkey long, and pockmarked where the hormones went finger painting across my face. My poor mother, how could this happen? You will have porcelain skin as soon as we can see a dermatologist. You sucked your thumb, that's why your teeth look like that. You were hit in the face with a frisbee when you were 6, otherwise your nose would have been just fine. Don't worry, we will get it all fixed, she would say, grasping my face, twisting it this way and that as if it was a cabbage she might buy. But this is not about her. It is not her fault that she too was raised to believe the greatest asset she could bestow upon her awkward little daughter was a marketable facade. By 16, I was pickled with ointments, medications, and peroxides, teeth corralled into steel prongs, laying in a hospital bed, face packed with gauze, cushioning the brand new nose the surgeon had just carved. Belly gorged on 2 pints of my own blood I had swallowed under anesthesia, and every convulsive twist of my gut, like my body screaming at me from the inside out, what did you let them do to you? And now I have not seen my own face in 10 years.
I have not seen in my own face in 10 years. But this is not about me. This is about the self-mutilating circus we have painted ourselves clowns in, about women who will call 30 stores and 6 malls to find the right cocktail dress, but haven't a clue where to find fulfillment or how to wear joy. Wandering through life shackled to a shopping bag beneath those two pretty syllables. About men wallowing on bar stools, drearily practicing attraction, and everyone who will drift home tonight crestfallen because not enough strangers found them suitably likable. This is about my someday daughter. When you approach me, already stung, stained with insecurity, begging, "Mom, will I be pretty? Will I be pretty?" I will wipe that question from your mouth like cheap lipstick and answer, "No." The word pretty is unworthy of everything you will be, and no child of mine will be contained in 5 letters. You will be pretty intelligent, pretty creative, pretty amazing, but you never will be simply pretty.
This was called The Phoenix. It was a couple years ago, but it's still good. The phoenix is strong. The phoenix is pure. Beauty at heart is always the cure. Till one day the feathers have fallen, the colors have dimmed. Once was pretty, now is only skin. Can't take much more, it goes up in flames, only to be reborn again as ashes remains.
This is called A Poet's Trigger. So what is a poet's trigger? Well, it's the red lace that runs up my arm that turns white when clean, healed. It's the titles of other poems dating my mental illness and did the therapy work. It's staying up till 1 because I can't write that damn essay and my mom took my last lighter. What do we do with this trigger? We spin some gold. We make the hate seem so pretty. Because only then you notice the bang of the gun. We make these triggers ours to give, to show you what's wrong with the world, with poems like Explaining White Supremacy to a White Supremacist and Anxiety, a Ghost Story. We give you these little facts about what keeps us awake at night, at class, at life. We show you our pain and little knowledges of a body can only panic for a maximum of 20 minutes. And how my manic pixie dream girl will treat you. So, what is a poet's trigger? It's fool's gold. We shine pretty light on it. But you can't see the poet's closet and how their clothes are not hung, but dirty on the floor. But you don't know the essay that made them slash idiot and failure down their thighs. You don't know the poems they listen to at night just so they can get some sleep. That, my dears, is a poet's trigger.
So this is not mine, but it is my favorite poem. It's by Maya Angelou, and it's called Cage Bird. A free bird leaps on the back of the wind and floats downstream till the current ends and dips his wings in the orange sun rays and dares to claim the sky. But a bird that stalks down his narrow cage can seldom see through his bars of rage. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. Cage bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill where the cage bird sings of freedom. The free bird thinks of another breeze, and the trade winds soft through the sighing trees, with fat worms waiting on a dawn bright lawn, and he names the sky his own. But a cage bird stands on the grave of his dreams, his shadows shout on a nightmare screen. His wings are clipped and his feet are tied, so he opens his throat to sing. The cage bird sings with a fearful trill of things unknown but longed for still, and his tune is heard on the distant hill where the cage bird sings of freedom.
Start where you stand and never mind the past. The past won't help you in beginning new. If you have left it all behind at last, why, that's enough. You're done with it. You're done with it. You're through. This is another chapter in the book. This is another race that you have planned. Don't give the vanished days a backward slope. Start where you stand. The world won't care about your old defeats if you can start anew and win success. The future is your time, and time is fleet, and there is much of work and strange dress. Forget the buried woes and dead despairs. Here is a brand new trial right at hand. The future is for him who does and dares. start where you stand. Old failures will not hold, old triumphs age. Today's the thing, tomorrow will soon be. Get in the fight and face it unafraid, and leave the past to ancient history. What has been has been. Yesterday is dead, and by it take courage. Be brave and drive ahead. Start with
in the event of my demise. In the event of my demise, when my heart can beat no more, I hope I die for a principle. Or I believe that I have lived for. I will die before my time, because I feel the shadow of death. So much I wanted to accomplish before I reach my death. I have come too gifted with the possibility to wipe the last tear from my eyes. I love to offer the positive in the event of my demise.
Balloon man, how exactly did you fly away? We lost you between the clouds and underneath the sun. We're weighed down by the rocks of our problems, hefty boulders formed by empty words and lost causes. You're an inspiration to us all, you know? But maybe you didn't know, since you left too soon for us to tell you. Was it easy to untie your nymph that hung you to this earth? Did you cut off your ties and journey alone? We only saw you in the sky floating on the airs of solitude and solace. Balloon man, many will follow your lead. We'll launch above the trees and skip along the mountaintops. This earth is no more for us. We are ready to leave and explore the plains beyond where freedom surely awaits.
I have another one. I'd like to hold hands, but I'm incapable. My hands become a swamp, all hot and clammy, you know? If I could control it, I would, but I'm too focused on keeping a storm of butterflies from coming from my throat. I'd like our mouths to meet, but I'm afraid my kiss is disappointing, my lips are toxic, and my breath kind of smells. You're like this sweet vanilla cupcake with this chocolatey center, every crevice and edge perfectly sculpted, and topped with that little frosting rosette. A soft buttercream complements that spongy texture of the cake itself. The rich dark chocolate spills out and decorates one's taste buds, the same way your words do. They pour out with the glimmer and shine within your eyes, say more than any words ever could. That decadent and luxurious delight is everything that makes you. I always thought I wanted someone to look at me this way, but I realized I just want to look at myself this way. This world is beautiful, and so am I. But my sweaty palms and unspoken sentences make me feel otherwise. Thank you.
So, before I read this, there have been a lot of poems tonight about some sadder things, and that's perfect. I'm not saying that's bad. That's one of the most powerful emotions that people have. And I feel like there are some of us in here who have had to support a lot of people that are down in the dumps and stuff like that. And this might sound a little harsh. It's not harsh, I promise. It's jokingly kind of saying that some people just need to grow up. Don't kill me, please. But it's just, yeah. I'm gonna start. It's called For the Falsely Transparent Lace. I'm shutting up and I'm letting go. You aren't the person that I used to know. And although I've been through hell for you, I think it's finally time you wore your big girl shoes. What do you expect from me? I've got one dream, for you to be happy. But how can I do that when you can't control yourself? Come on, stand up. Toys go on the shelf. You act like such a little kid that fights and argues to no end. You have finally lost my bid. Here's your own life to defend. Always pushing us away, even when you want to stay. Now you have your final wish. Down the eternal drain you swish. Don't come back to me for answers. Lies are all that will need false answers. I'll admit, every rose has its thorns. Every heart hurts and mourns. You are absolutely astoundingly gorgeous, and that's the least interesting thing about you. Don't lose sight of it.
Something that I wrote for myself quite a while back, and I just feel like it's something that to be and stay strong. That when something bad happens, to just stay strong. That through our lives, we can do anything as long as we stay strong. We can climb the tallest mountain, jump the highest, and accomplish the most. But everyone has a different capability of strength. You can only stay strong for so long until you pull a muscle, until you break a bone. When you do, what happens? You're taught constantly to stay strong, but you never learned what to do if you were weak. You never learned how to act when you're broken. You never learned how to cope when you're injured. I'm not just talking about muscles and the bones of your skeletal structure. We are not taught that it is okay to be weak, that you can only stay strong for so long. So this is for those who are not taught the equal balance of things. You cannot be strong if you were never weak. After maintaining a smile, it's okay for it to be crooked. It's okay for you to cry after being strong for as long as you have. It's okay to break, because one day you'll heal, and you'll be stronger than ever, as cheesy as it is.
Woo!
Thanks.
Before you date me. Number one, I like cats. No, love. Like, I really love cats. Warm bundles of fuzz made of headbutts and loud purrs. If you don't like cats, it might be a problem, and I don't think we'll work out. Number two, I am a hopeless romantic despite my feminist tendencies. Number three, I like to eat, as you might have guessed. Emotional eating is a burden I carry. To date me, you should be able to tolerate my insecurities, because sometimes I feel like a circus act. Come one, come all to the eating disorder circus. Over there, you can see the anorexic acrobat. And there you see the act of bulimia. And right before your very eyes, you can see binge eating disorder, because the show isn't over until the fat lady sings. Number four. Four is one of my favorite numbers. And so is 7 and 28. What do you know? 4 times 7 is 28. I'm kind of a nerd. Number five. Handle me with care. I can be steadfast and sturdy, but also very fragile and delicate. Some say that admitting this makes me weak, but I think it makes me strong. I know when I bend and break. I know my limits, and I know when I will shatter. Do not mistake the fact that I am glass for weakness. Number six, I love to learn. Teach me to love you, and I will love you until the end of time. Number seven. 7 is one of my favorite numbers. Thank you.
Bear with me with this one. This one was made like sophomore year. My IB kids in the back, and that was like Megan's assignment that we have to do. So y'all know it. So here you go. My sophomore year self. Oh, wait, sorry, quick backstory. I was walking home one time to the hospital, and there was like this guy there, and yeah, there we go. So that's all it is. His words were bitter, like a grape too small, or just comparing him to the world and all. I expressed concern because of what I saw, for his size mingled and tender and raw. I was on play, and he was on pause, stopped in a moment before I poked at his flaws, which made me regret offering his kindness to whom I had said. He cackled far too loud for it to be real, and gestured to his leg, the one that can't heal, and threw my question back like the butt of a joke. I blubbered like a fool, so ashamed I choked. With rushed apologies, I moved into motion, my legs hardly lift, copying his notion. As cool as it seemed, I heard him gently say, "It bounds back. Is anyone really okay?" So this one is another one from like a couple years ago. So again, it's called Femme Fatale. Celestial in being, mythical in part. Men told many legends, and you painted her as art. But once you got a taste, a little drop upon your tongue, you suddenly felt the pain, a little prick that really stung. It spread across your body, a fire to fight the cold. It overwhelmed you. Oh, your body cold. Your blood hit the ground running, a marathon against time. You are also art, your song, exquisite and sublime.
We've all heard of pineapple on pizza and that big fiasco. Well, I recently heard about my friend, and she was talking about how you should put salt on watermelon. And I freaked out. I was like, what do you mean salt on watermelon? Who just does that? So this one is called, and the title is an inspiration by my sweet Madison Beebe.
Something should not have in my mouth be crunchy. Okay, so salt does not go on watermelon. We've all established this. It doesn't sound good. It probably doesn't taste good. But salt does not go on watermelon. The only salt that should be involved with watermelon is my own salt that I'm coaxed in over the mere concept of salt being put on watermelon. They don't go together. No matter how hungry, I would not ever, ever get munchy on that funky chunk of junk someone calls a snack. And that's it. Thank you.
I want you to be part of Iron and Reeds. We're a pretty cool club. We have food. We host the Iron and Reeds event and poetry night. We want you to be here. So express yourself with Iron and Reeds.